Hello everyone, myself Dr. M. Srijan Kumar. My education background is pharmacy. Today's topic is herbal drug and herbal food interactions. Before going on to the topic, first let us understand the definition of interaction. Interaction is a kind of action that occurs as two or more objects have an effect upon one another. What do you mean by the term interaction? It is a kind of action that occurs as two or more objects have an effect upon one another. This is the definition of interaction. Now let us move on to the topic, introduction of your herbal drug and herbal food interactions. First we will understand the definition of a drug interaction, then followed by herb drug interaction, and what is the difference between your herb drug interaction and drug-drug interaction. Okay, a drug interaction is a change in the action or side effects of a drug caused by concomitant administration with a food, beverage, supplement or another drug. Okay, so what do you mean by drug interaction? If there is any alteration in the action of your drug, okay, if your drug is producing any sort of side effects, when that particular drug given in combination with food, beverage or supplement or any other drug. Okay, if you are given a drug in combination with the above, it might be either food, it might be either beverage, it might be either your supplement or it might be either another drug. Okay, if there is any alteration in the action of your drug or if your drug is producing any sort of side effects, then that particular interaction is called as drug interaction. Okay, so here the next definition is herb drug interaction. So in the name itself, herb drug, that means that a particular conventional drug is given in combination with your herbal medicine, then it will result in an interaction called as herb drug interaction. Okay, so whenever you are giving a conventional drug, you need to be contraindicated with your herbal drug. Okay, that means that you need to have clear understanding on the possible side effects and possible adverse effects of combination of your herbal drug with your conventional drug. When you don't have that understanding, ultimately you will end up with toxic effects. Okay, these types of interactions may be more common than drug-drug interactions. Okay, herb-drug interactions are more common than your drug-drug interactions. Why? What is the reason, you know? Because when you see drug-drug interactions, when you say a drug, drug will contains only one active ingredient. Okay, so but when you come across this herbal medicines, herbal drug will contain multiple pharmacologically active ingredients. Okay, so as it contains multiple pharmacologically active ingredients in herbal medicine, so these herb drug interactions are very common in your herbal medications rather than your conventional drugs. Okay, the only reason is presence of pharmacologically active ingredients. It will be more in your herbal medicines, but it will be a single moiety in your conventional drugs. Clear? Yeah. Now let us move on to types of drug interactions. The first type is drug-drug interactions. There are about 5 types of drug interactions. Okay, the first type is drug-drug interactions. So what is drug-drug interaction? A reaction between two or more drugs is called as drug-drug interaction. An example of this is someone who take a diuretic, a drug that attempts to rid the body of excess water and salt, and also takes ibuprofen. The ibuprofen may reduce the diuretic's effectiveness because ibuprofen often causes the body to retain salt and fluid. So here the example for your drug-drug interaction is the first drug is a diuretic drug and the second drug is a ibuprofen. So what is the purpose of diuretic drug here? Diuretic drug will attempt to rid the body of excess water and salt. This is the mechanism of action of your diuretic drug. But when this diuretic drug is given in combination with your ibuprofen, what happens? This ibuprofen, it will reduce the diuretic activity. it will reduce the diuretic activity. In what way? By retaining the body salt and fluids. By retaining the body fluids and salt. Okay. So the role of diuretic to get rid. But your ibuprofen, what it is doing? It is making retention of your salt and body fluids. Thereby it is reducing the effectiveness of your diuretic drug. This is your drug-drug interaction. I hope you understand. Next, drug-food interaction. Drug-food interaction. When food or beverage intake alters a drug's effect, that particular interaction is called as drug-food interactions. So, the example given is statins to lower cholesterol drinks. Cholesterol drinks, a lot of grapefruit juice. This can cause too much of the drug to stay in the body. This may increase the risk for liver damage or kidney failure. Here the present interaction we are going to discuss about drug and food. So when you are on a particular medication, so what type of food should be avoided? Okay, that is nothing but drug food interaction. So we don't know what type of food should be avoided. Now here there is an example given here. So statins are the drugs, okay, are the category of drugs which lower your cholesterol. When you are on medication of that particular statins, okay, and that same person, he is having lot of grapefruit juice, what happens, you know, here this particular grapefruit juice will retain your drug in your body for prolonged period of time. Okay, the mechanism here, your grapefruit juice will help your statins to stay in your body for prolonged period of time. As it is allowing your statins to stay in your body for prolonged period of time, by this what it will cause? It will cause risk to the liver damage. At the same time, it will cause kidney failure also. Because every drug will be having its own half-life. Okay, what do you mean by half-life? Time taken for the drug to degrade half of its initial concentration. For example, assume that a drug has been taken. Now the half-life of the drug is 2 hours. That means that what is the maximum time that particular drug to be stayed in our body? 4 hours, approximately 4 hours. When you say that if you are on that statin medication and the half-life of a drug is 2 hours, maximum time period to be stayed in our body is 4 hours, but at the same time you are having lot of grapefruit juice. Okay, when you are having lot of grapefruit juice, ultimately this grapefruit juice, what is this going to do? It is going to make your drug to stay in your body for prolonged period of time. Thereby what happens? The half-life will get increased. So thereby it will induce the risk to liver and kidney. Okay, this is about your drug food interaction. Yeah, next type of interaction is drug alcohol interaction. Certain medications that should not be taken with alcohol. So when you are on certain medications, you should avoid taking alcohol. So when you are taking alcohol in combination with your drug, ultimately it will result in an interaction called as drug alcohol. So the example is when you are on medications like sedatives and hypnotics, you should avoid using alcohol. Okay. Next, drug disease interaction. Okay. In some disease conditions, you need to avoid some drugs. That means nothing but when you are on some disease conditions, you need to have a contraindication for some drugs. Okay, already it will be written on the label of your drug that these particular drugs are contraindicated in so and so disease conditions. Okay, the use of a drug that alters or worsens a conditions or disease the person has. Okay. That particular interaction is called as drug disease. Okay, the drug which you are going to take, it may alter the disease condition, it may worsen the disease condition. For example, certain decongestant people take for cold can increase blood pressure. This is potentially dangerous interaction for people with high blood pressure called as hypertension. Okay, so already the person is on medication for hypertension. Okay, he is suffering from a disease called as hypertension and he is on medication. Okay, having that, if he is going on for some other additional medications like decongestants for cold and flu, okay, decongestants for cold and flu, this decongestants will increase the blood pressure, it will result in hypertension. Okay, so one must be very careful. A person suffering from hypertension should avoid what? Decongestants. Should avoid what? Decongestant. This particular knowledge should be there for the person who is on hypertension. Okay, next, drug laboratory. So when a medication interferes with a laboratory test, such interaction is called as drug laboratory. Now you are aimed for testing the patient, and when that particular test results are getting altered or that particular test results are inaccurate, okay, so here we need to understand that, yeah, there is an interaction between your test and your already the person who is on medication. Okay, so this can result in inaccurate test results. For instance, certain antidepressants, the examples which alter your laboratory test, here the example given as certain antidepressants, especially tricyclic antidepressants, have been shown to interfere with skin prick test used to determine allergies someone may have. A particular person suffering from allergies, okay, and you want to diagnose him, so you are going for testing, but the test is called a skin prick test. So when you are doing that, okay, this particular tricyclic antidepressants may interfere with your test results. Okay, this is about your drug laboratory interaction. That's all about your five types of drug interactions. Yeah, next we will move on to your present topic, herbal drug and herbal food interactions. Here I have given some information about some herbs which will show interaction with the drug, and it will show interaction with some food materials also. So we will discuss that. So the first herb is St. John's wort. The first herb is St. John's wort. The synonym is hypericum. The synonym is hypericum. Okay. Now coming to the constituents of your St. John's wort, the main groups of active constituents of St. John's wort are thought to be anthraquinones. The main constituents are anthraquinones, which include hypericin, isohypericin, pseudohypericin, protohypericin, proto-pseudohypericin, and cyclo-pseudohypericin, and cyclo-pseudohypericin. These are your anthraquinones, okay, and the prenylated fluoroglucinols. Apart from that, the prenylated fluoroglucinols, that includes hyperforin and adiperforin. Not only your anthraquinones and phenylated fluoroglucinols, it also contains flavonoids, which include kempferol, quercetin, luteolin, hyperoside, isoquercetrin, quercetrin, and rutin, biflavonoids which include biapigenin, and amentoflavone, and it also contains catechins. These are the constituents of your St. John's wort. Now coming to the use and indications. St. John's wort is widely used to treat mild to moderate depression, used in the treatment of depression disorders. Seasonal affective disorder, low mood, anxiety, and insomnia. Insomnia are nothing but sleep disorders. Insomnia, if it is particularly associated with menopause. It has also been used topically for its astringent properties. When you opt this St. John's herb for oral administration, it will be used for depression disorders, seasonal affective disorders, anxiety, insomnia, etc. And if you want to formulate this St. John's wort herb as a topical formulation, it has its astringent properties. That's all about use and indications. Next, we'll move on to your interactions. Of St. John's wort. So, St. John's wort taken in combination with 5-aminolevulinic acid. When St. John's wort is taken along with 5-aminolevulinic acid, what happens? Okay, it results in severe phototoxic reaction. Okay, and this effect is called as synergistic effect. So when you are on medication with 5-aminolevulinic acid, okay, you should not take St. John's wort. Okay, so it will result in an interaction called as severe phototoxic reaction. Next, St. John's wort plus benzodiazepines. So long-term use of St. John's wort decreases the plasma levels of alprazolam, midazolam, and quazepam. Okay, so when you are on long-term use of your St. John's wort, ultimately if you are going with a medication called as benzodiazepines, okay, the examples for your benzodiazepine drugs has been given here: alprazolam, midazolam, and quazepam. Okay, so what this St. John's wort will do, you know, it will just decrease the plasma levels of this benzodiazepines. It will result in decrease in plasma levels of benzodiazepines. Okay, St. John's wort preparations taken as a single dose or containing low hyperforin levels appear to have less of an effect. So when you compare the effect of your St. John's wort, if it is taken as single dose, not an issue. Okay, it will be having less effect when compared to long-term use. Okay, next, St. John's wort plus calcium channel blockers. Okay, here taking St. John's wort along with calcium channel blockers. The drugs which belongs to calcium channel blockers category, examples given as nifedipine and verapamil. When calcium channel blockers like your nifedipine and verapamil have been taken along with your St. John's wort, okay, this St. John's wort will reduce the bioavailability of your nifedipine and verapamil. Any drug that is administered to the patient, what patient will expect? He will expect 100% bioavailability. But unfortunately, when these calcium channel blockers have been taken in combination with your St. John's wort, this St. John's wort will reduce the bioavailability of calcium channel blockers. Okay. And there are some, not only your nifedipine and verapamil, there are some other drugs which belongs to calcium channel blockers category. Okay, will be also affected in the same manner where your nifedipine and verapamil are affected. Okay, next, St. John's wort taken along with cyclosporin. When St. John's wort are taken along with cyclosporin, okay, there are marked reductions in cyclosporin blood levels. The first thing that happened is reduction in cyclosporin blood levels. Okay, it is an interaction, and apart from that, there is also transplant rejection can occur within a few weeks of starting St. John's wort. Okay, a person has undergone a transplant rejection. Okay, and he has been on medication with your cyclosporin. Okay, And along with the cyclosporine, if you start taking the St. John's wort, okay? So within a few weeks of starting your St. John's wort herb, okay, it will result in transplant rejection. Okay? Next, St. John's wort taking along with chlorzoxazone. So it will result in increased clearance of your chlorzoxazone. Okay. So increased or decreased clearance will affect the activity of your drug. Okay. Yeah, that's all about interactions. And apart from these, all these interactions are St. John's wort with your drug. Okay. So that means that the herb drug interaction. In the next section, we will deal with herb and food interaction. St. John's wort taken along with food. Okay, we'll see what type of interactions are. An isolated report describes a patient taking St. John's wort who experienced a hypertensive crisis after consuming thiamine-rich food and drink. Okay, already the person is on St. John's wort herb medication, and this particular person has been taken some food and drinks that are rich in thiamine. Okay, ultimately taking food and drinks that are rich in thiamine will result in hypertension crisis. Okay, this is the possible food interaction with your St. John's wort. Okay, next we will move on to the another herb, kava kava. The synonym is Piper methysticum. The constituent present in kava kava are pyrones, lactones. The lactones that are available are methysticin, dihydromethysticin, abbreviated as DMH. Yangonin, dihydrocavin, also called as cavin. Apart from your pyrones and lactones, it also contains flavonoids and alkaloids. Among the constituents that are present, cavin is considered as one of the principal biologically active components of kava. Coming to the use and indications, this kava has anti-anxiety effect and sleep promoting effect. The primary use of kava is reducing stress and anxiety. Research suggests that kava could help treat the symptoms of anxiety disorders. Not only reducing stress and anxiety, the research that has been suggested that this particular kava will be helpful in treating anxiety disorders. Okay. Apart from your anti-anxiety effects, it also has sleep promoting effects. Kava kava could help induce sleep due to anxiolytic effects. Okay. Due to anxiolytic effects of your kava, okay, what kava will hold, it will induce sleep. For this reason, people also use it as an alternative therapy for sleep disorders. Apart from sleep medications that are available in the market, you can also take kava kava as an alternative therapy for sleep disorders. Okay, next. Let us move on to the interactions of your kava herb with different drug categories. The first one is kava taken along with alprazolam. Okay, the brand name of alprazolam is Xanax. We know that kava causes drowsiness. Alprazolam also induces drowsiness. So one should avoid taking kava along with alprazolam. Why? Because as we know that two drugs are causing drowsiness. So when we take two drugs in combination, it will produce more drowsiness. Okay. That should be avoided. Next, kava taken along with CNS depressants. The CNS depressants drugs that have been given here are clonazepam, lorazepam, phenobarbital, zolpidem and others. We know that kava causes sleepiness. The medication that cause sleepiness are called as your sedatives. Okay, so one should avoid taking kava while you are on sedative medications like your clonazepam, which belongs to the category of your CNS depressants, because it will induce more sleep. Okay, so you need to be very careful while taking kava along with this medication because it will induce more sleep. Next, kava taken along with levodopa. We know that levodopa will produce dopamine. Okay, so this kava will interact with your levodopin and it will result in decreased dopamine in the brain. Okay, so taking kava along with levodopa might decrease the effectiveness of levodopa. Okay, levodopa is meant for producing dopamine. Okay, but kava, what it will do, it will interact with your levodopa and it will reduce the effectiveness of your levodopa. Okay, next, kava taken along with lovastatin. Kava taken along with lovastatin. Some medications are changed and broken down by the liver. Okay, there are some medications, their pharmacological activity will be changed or it will be broken by the liver, because liver contains some enzymes called as enzyme substrate called as cytochrome P450 and others. Okay, this kava will interact with such substrates and it will not allow these particular medications to get broken down. Okay, this is how your kava will interact with your lovastatin kind of drugs. The next interaction, kava taken along with food. Okay, what are the food interactions that can be resulted while taking along with kava? So avoid drinking alcohol while taking kava. Alcohol may increase your risk of liver damage. So when you are on kava medication, avoid taking alcohol, it will damage the liver. Avoid using kava together with other herb or herb health supplements that can also harm the liver. So when you are on kava medication, you need to avoid other herbal or health supplements also. Okay, because it will result in damage to the liver. That's all about your interactions about your kava. Yeah, next we'll move on to the next herb called as Ginkgo biloba. Ginkgo biloba. The synonym of Ginkgo biloba are fossil tree, kew tree, maidenhair tree. Fossil tree, kew tree, maidenhair tree. The constituents present are, so two parts of this plant where your phytochemical constituents are present. One is leaves, Ginkgo leaves and Ginkgo seeds. So let us see the constituents that are present in Ginkgo leaves. So Ginkgo leaves contain numerous flavonoids including biflavone glycosides such as zinc jetin, isozinc jetin, bilobetin, cyadopitisin, and also some quercetin and camphorol, derivatives. Not only flavonoids, it also contains terpene lactones, which acts as a major component, and these include zincolites A, B, and C, and bilobelite. Coming to the seeds, of your Ginkgo biloba contain zincotoxin, chemically it is 4-O-methylpyridoxine, and zincolic acid. Coming to the use and indications, the leaves of Ginkgo are the part usually used. The usually part of your Ginkgo biloba is the leaf part. Okay. Ginkgo is often used to improve cognitive function in case of dementia and memory loss. It is used to improve cognitive function in the case of dementia and memory loss, and it has been investigated for used in the treatment of Alzheimer's disease. Mainly this ginkgo biloba leaves has been investigated in the treatment of Alzheimer's disease. Okay, the zincolytes are thought to process. These zincolytes not only used in the treatment of your Alzheimer's disease, it also has antiplatelet and anti-inflammatory properties. Apart from treatment of Alzheimer's disease, it also has antiplatelet and anti-inflammatory properties. It is used for cerebrovascular and peripheral vascular disorders. Cerebrovascular and peripheral vascular disorders. Okay, it is also used in tinnitus. Okay, what is tinnitus? It is nothing but ringing and buzzing in the ear is called as tinnitus. Ringing and buzzing in the ear, it is called as tinnitus. It is also used in the treatment of asthma. It is also used in the treatment of asthma and also used to relieve the symptom of altitude sickness. Altitude sickness is nothing but someone are very much feared about heights. So in such conditions, you can take this ginkgo biloba to relieve the symptoms of altitude sickness. These are the use and indications of your ginkgo biloba. Yeah. Let us move on to the section of interaction of your ginkgo herb with different drug categories. So ginkgo plus antiepileptics. Ginkgo when taken along with antiepileptics. So here the antiepileptics drugs have been given, valproate and phenytoin. Actually antiepileptics are given to the patient to reduce the seizures. But unfortunately, when antiepileptics have been given along with this ginkgo biloba, case report suggested that this ginkgo biloba are inducing seizures into the patient. Ginkgo biloba inducing seizures into the patient. So one should avoid taking ginkgo biloba along with antiepileptics. Next, ginkgo plus antiplatelet drugs. Ginkgo plus antiplatelet drugs. And here also the same. Okay. So ginkgo biloba has been associated with platelet bleeding and clotting disorders. And when given along with the drugs such as your antiplatelet drugs such as aspirin, clopidogrel and ticlopidine. One should avoid taking ginkgo biloba along with your antiplatelet drugs. Next, ginkgo plus calcium channel blockers. Ginkgo taken along with calcium channel blockers. So what will happen when you take ginkgo along with calcium channel blockers? It will increase the levels and it will also alter the effects of your nifedipine. It will increase the levels of your nifedipine. Okay. Plasma levels of your lipidipine. At the same time, it also alter the effects of your nifedipine. Okay. Next, ginkgo plus risperidone. So here when ginkgo has been taken along with your risperidone, okay, here they have observed a case report that this ginkgo has caused priapism in a patient taking risperidone along with ginkgo. Okay, they have observed that priapism in a patient taking risperidone and ginkgo. What do you mean by priapism? It is persistent and painful erection of penis. The condition where persistent and painful erection of penis, that particular condition is called as priapism. So one should avoid taking ginkgo along with risperidone. Okay. Next, taking ginkgo along with proton pump inhibitors. taking zinco along with proton pump inhibitors. So when zinco has been taken along with proton pump inhibitors, it has induced the metabolism of omeprazole. The example for proton pump inhibitors here, we have given it as omeprazole. Not only omeprazole, the similar, it has been affected to all the proton pump inhibitors. It is inducing the metabolism of your proton pump inhibitors. Next, we will move on to the section called as interaction of your zinco help with food. Okay, there are no possible interaction found between your zinco and food supplements. We'll move on to the next herb called as ginseng. Ginseng, yeah, the synonyms are Panax ginseng and Panax quinquefolius. Panax ginseng and Panax quinquefolius. These are two plant species. Okay, this Panax quinquefolius is it is called as American ginseng. It is also called as American ginseng. Yeah, the constituents of your ginseng are saponin glycosides such as ginsenosides or panaxocides. Coming to the use and indications of your ginseng, use and indications. Ginseng is used to enhance the body resistance to stress. It is used to enhance the body resistance to stress and to improve mental and physical performance. It also helps to improve the mental and physical performance. Not only that, it has been used for diabetes, insomnia, as I said, sleep disorders, sexual inadequacy, for degenerative conditions associated with aging. Okay, we know that on aging, the sexual inadequacy is the problem that arises. So in such conditions, you can use ginseng herb to improve healing and as a stimulant. Interactions. Coming to the interactions. So ginseng will, the interaction that has been noticed here as, it is interacting with your laboratory tests. Ginseng has been shown to interfere with some methods of measuring serum digoxin, especially digoxin SS. When someone want to assay the digoxin levels in your serum, or they want to do some digoxin assay, when that particular person is on medication with your ginseng herb, ultimately it is interfering with the results and providing inaccurate results. Okay, so that is one interaction, ginseng plus laboratory test, because this is a fifth type of interaction that we have been discussing in the second slide under the section called as types of interactions. Okay, next, ginseng taken along with mouse monoamino oxidase inhibitors. Mouse is nothing but monoamino oxidase inhibitors. So case reports describe headache, insomnia and tremulousness, which was attributed to the concurrent use of ginseng and phenelzine. So phenelzine is a drug that comes under the category of MAOs. When ginseng used along with your phenelzine, okay, the case report has been described that there are some interactions like headache, insomnia and tremulousness. Next, ginseng taken along with warfarin. One pharmacological study found that Panax quinquefolius, as I said, it is an American ginseng. This particular Panax quinquefolius has been taken along with your warfarin. Okay, it has resulted in decrease the effect of warfarin. It has been resulted in decreasing the effect of warfarin. So one should avoid taking this Panax quinquefolius along with warfarin. Okay. Next, ginseng taken along with tamoxifen and other estrogen antagonists. So this ginseng may contain estrogenic compounds that might directly stimulate breast cancer growth. Okay, these insects may contain estrogenic compounds. Okay, what is the role of these estrogenic compounds? You know, this may directly stimulate your breast cancer growth and oppose the action of competitive estrogen receptor antagonists such as tamoxifen. Okay, tamoxifen will be indicated to the patient. So, in order to play a role called as competitive estrogen receptor agonist, but that particular role will be defended by your ginseng. This is the drug interaction between your ginseng and tamoxifen. Why? In what way? Because it already contains estrogenic compounds. It will result in stimulating the breast cancer growth. Here there is a clause. However, there is some evidence that ginseng used before diagnosis might not adversely affect breast cancer survival. So, it is before the diagnosis, there will be no harm, but after the diagnosis, ultimately it will result in stimulating your breast cancer. Next, coming to the next section, interaction of your ginseng with food. So, Panax ginseng increases the clearance of alcohol and lowers blood alcohol levels. When Panax ginseng has been taken along with your alcohol, it will just help in clearing the alcohol from your body as well as from your blood. Okay. Yeah. No possible interactions found with other food supplements. Next, coming to the next herb, garlic. The synonym is Azo Allium. Azo Allium. So, coming to the constituents, garlic products are produced from the bulbs, cloves of garlic. We know that. Sulfur containing compounds like alline and allicin are present. Apart from that, allyl methyl trisulfide, allyl propyl disulfide, dialyl trisulfide, azoin and vinyl dithins and mercaptan. Apart from that, it also contains glycosides, monoterpenoids, enzymes, vitamins, minerals and flavonoids based on chemferol and quercetin. Coming to the use and indications, garlic has been used to treat respiratory infections such as cold, flu, chronic bronchitis, nasal and throat catarrh. Okay, it has been used to treat respiratory infections such as cold, flu, chronic bronchitis and nasal and throat catarrh and cardiovascular diseases. Also in the treatment of cardiovascular diseases, it is believed to possess, apart from treating your cardiovascular diseases, apart from having your respiratory infection properties, treating your respiratory infections, it also has antihypertensive effect, antithrombotic, fibrinolytic, antimicrobial, anti-cancer, expectorant, anti-diabetic and lipid lowering factors. Anti-diabetic and lipid lowering properties. There are numerous applications of your garlic, especially therapeutic applications. Yeah, next, moving on to the interactions. Interactions of garlic when used along with ACE inhibitors. So the drug that has been given as an example here for ACE inhibitors is lisinopril. Okay, so a particular patient has resulted marked hypotension and became faint after taking garlic capsules along with lisinopril. Okay, a person has been reported with marked hypotension and become faint after taking garlic capsules along with lisinopril, which comes under the drug category called as ACE inhibitors. That is the interaction. Next interaction, garlic taken along with antiplatelet drugs. So, garlic, as we said, that it has antiplatelet properties. Okay. So, when garlic has been taken with antiplatelet drugs, so it may increase the risk of bleeding. It may increase the risk of bleeding. Okay, it's an adverse effect when garlic taken along with an antiplatelet drugs. Next, garlic taken along with protease inhibitors. Garlic taken along with protease inhibitors. So, a garlic supplement reduces the plasma levels of saquinavir. Saquinavir is nothing but a protease inhibitor. So, when garlic has been taken along with the combination of your protein inhibitor called as saquinavir, it has reduced the plasma levels. It has reduced the plasma levels and it has been observed in one case study. Next, garlic taken along with food, there is no possible interactions found. Garlic taken along with food, there are no possible interactions found. Next, moving on to the herb called as pepper. Pepper. Yeah, the synonyms are Piper nigrum L, Piper nigrum L and Piper longum L. These are plant species. This pepper can be also called as black pepper and white pepper. So called as black pepper and white pepper. The constituents present in pepper are alkaloids and alkylamides. The most important being among these, the most important constituent of your pepper being piperin. Piperin and piperitin, piper longumine, piper nonaline, lignans and minor constituents such as piperoleans. Coming to the use and indications of pepper, it is used as stimulant and carbonative and it is an ingredient widely used in all foods. It is used as a stimulant and carbonative and it is reputed to have anti-asthmatic used in the treatment of asthma conditions, antioxidant, antimicrobial, hepatoprotective and hypocholesterolemic effect. Okay, used in the treatment of cholesterol disorders. Okay, yeah, interactions. Coming to the interactions, pepper while taking along with nevirapine. So the main active constituents of pepper is piperin. This piperin that is present in pepper markedly increase the AUC of single dose of nevirapine. It has been increased the AUC of single dose of nevirapine. AUC is nothing but area under curve. I hope you know better about AUC. So it will markedly increase the AUC of single dose of nevirapine. Next, pepper while taken along with phenytoin. So piperin appears to increase the maximum levels and AUC of phenytoin. So piperin while taken along with phenytoin, it will increase the plasma levels as well as AUC of phenytoin. Okay, but there is a clause here. This particular increasing the maximum levels of your AUC of phenytoin. Okay, this particular effect will be less in patients receiving long-term phenytoin. This particular effect will be less in patients who are receiving long-term phenytoin. Next, pepper taken along with theophylline. So here the piperin, almost it will double the AUC of your theophylline. All these are nothing but altering your drug activity. Okay. So doubling the AEC is nothing but ultimately there will be a change in the drug activity. It will produce adverse effects as well as side effects. Next, pepper taken along with rifampicin. Here also this piperine increase the AUC of rifampicin. Next, pepper taken along with propranolol. Pepper taken along with propranolol. So piperine pretreatment increase the AUC of single dose of propranolol by twofold in a study in healthy subjects. Here also, in the case of your propranolol, while pepper has been taken along with propranolol, there is an twofold increase in your piperine. Okay, while studying with the pretreatment with your piperine. Next, coming to the pepper taken along with food, there are no possible interactions found with the food. As we know that pepper is the ingredient used in almost all the foods in our day-to-day life. Next, going on to the herb called as ephedra. Going on to the herb called as ephedra. The synonym is mahuang. Mahuang. And the plant species are like ephedra sinica stap. Ephedra sinica stap. Ephedra gerardiana. Ephedra gerardiana wall. Ephedra gerardiana wall. Ephedra equisetina bung. Ephedra equisetina bung. Coming to the constituents present in ephedra: ephedrine, pseudoephedrine, norephedrine, nor pseudoephedrine, N-methylephedrine, ephedroxane, mavoconine, mavoconine, a series of ephedradienes and others. A series of ephedradienes and others. Apart from this, there are other constituents that are present as terpenes, diterpenes, diterpenes, ephedranin A and mahuanin, mahuanin, catechins. Not only these diterpenes, ephedranin and catechins, it also contains volatile oil like terpenin 4 all, alpha terpeniol, alpha terpeniol, linalool, linalool and other monoterpenes. Linalool and other monoterpenes. Coming to the use and indications. Use and indications. Ephedra is traditionally used for asthma, bronchitis, hay fever and colds. Hay fever and colds. But recently, the herb has become more liable to abuse as stimulant and slimming aid. But recently, the present literature shows that herb has become liable to abuse as a stimulant and slimming aid. Okay. Yeah, coming to the indications, ephedra taken along with maos and kefin. Ephedra taken along with maos or ephedra taken along with kefin. Okay. The possible interactions are hypertensive crisis. The possible interactions are hypertensive crisis when ephedra taken along with maos or ephedra taken along with kefin. And ephedra taken along with food, there are no interactions found. There are no possible interactions found. That's all about your today's session. Herbal drug and herbal food interactions. Dear viewers, please view, like, share and subscribe to my channel. Please subscribe to my channel. Thank you. Thank you very much.